Okay, I think you guys figure out who I am. It's right here. And this is a jointly sponsored adventure by the Planning Commission of Vancouver. And there's supposed to be a few members here. Marta here is the chair, and she's going to take part in commanding the last part of the session. There's nobody else here from the commission, is there? No. Eileen, of course, the deputy chair of the Sustainable Planning Committee. We had to partner because of a number of reasons, but it actually gave us great benefit. We had somebody, because we could partner with New City Institute and Post Carbon Institute and gets tax write-offs, we have an anonymous sponsor who actually paid for your lunch and this room today.
Thank you. A few cheese in the room.
This is about partnering and learning to work together. I guess that's part of the process. And Post Carbon, of course, who's really been in this longer than we have, is sort of the leading edge around here, and it's good they're in Vancouver. And Julian Darley is here, and Laura and Sarah are supposed to be here, but she isn't. Other than that, I guess that's the main introductions. If I've missed anybody, put up your hand now. Oh, Bryn, pardon me. Bryn, major presentation here. He's come in, stepped in, and helped whip this thing into a shape and pushed it in some directions, which I wanted to resist at first, but I think it's got better. He was concerned that last year's thing might have been too abstract, and so we're actually doing some physical planning for those that want to do that part, or at least looking at landscapes and impact. But there's still room for people that want to look at the impact of peak oil with business or environment or social cultural problems. My little spiel is sort of like the big picture geopolitical and paradigm shift thing. I'll just start with this. This is actually based on the peak oil Hubbert's curve, but with actually bringing in the way Bryn is going to go into the problem solving aspect later. My take on it, though, is cities exist in time and place because of the energy and technology they deal with. And the cities before oil came along were one thing. The cities we have now are another thing. But depending on which way we go, the cities are going to become something else. So everything you take for granted in terms of services, buildings, highways, how you get around, everything in your life changes depending on how much oil or other energy you have. And as oil is the most compact, accessible, wonderful ingredient, which we have now blown in a couple generations, the cities we have cannot be sustainable. Everything we now praise ourselves for doing in terms of little green pointy towers or everything else we now call sustainable are in fact baby steps which are not going to be sustainable when the oil is gone. So our exercise today is to talk about how our cities and pattern of community changes to accommodate the rapid change coming. This requires an overused word maybe, but a paradigm shift or a quantum leap, a sideways step, because conventional planning in a stable society was always like whatever your grandfather did, you wind up doing, and likely your grandkids will do. In the last period with cheap oil, options opened up, and we talked about Star Trek and all those other wonderful things. There's no end to what we can do. And so we looked at exploring new options, and we talked about alternate futures. But we run into a crisis like this where society has to change radically. So it's not good enough to talk about the small steps anymore. And it is a paradigm shift. Or a quantum change, like in chemistry, when you go from ice to water or to vapor, we've been living in sort of a constant state, say water, and now we're about to go into something else. It's like tomorrow you wake up and you're not in Vancouver, you're in Bangladesh. So what we have to look at is when the change takes place, if we're not careful and we go down the collapse curve, we'll have a paradigm shift in a place we don't want to be. So our exercise is to think and get people aware, raise consciousness, create new leaders who deal with a paradigm shift to places that is a more comfortable place. So this is the soft landing in the whole fear of flying explanation. We've got to seize control of the airplane, take it out of the dive, find a place to land. There's a whole bunch of other things we have to deal with at the same time. We've got global warming, which is actually an offshoot related to this, but we're not using that as the focus because global warming is going to happen, but this is something we can control because the energy issue and how we live our lifestyle, how we plan our cities, we can control that. Even though at the time, we're probably trying to figure out how to get above rising tide, We have a map somewhere around here that shows the new coastline of BC with a 6-meter tide raise. The other thing we have to deal with in this generation is the impact of the baby boomer on different parts. Like right now we have to worry about housing and the youngsters come along, but the baby boomer hit them the hospital system in the next 10, 15, 20 years. That's one thing. The other thing that happens with global warming and energy crisis is that we have world mass migrations, and these have a dialogue to go with them, but just take a look at them because it talks about people escaping disease and overcrowding or going to places where they know there's more energy, like Americans coming to Canada, for instance. I'll say that because we've got a few Americans in the room here who moved here already and some are thinking about it. And the other thing is overpopulation caused by all this combination of factors. And you can quibble with the detail or how it arrived at the conclusion, but when you combine all the factors, Vancouver is one of those places on the world map that a lot of people want to come to when you look at all those things. So even though we might have declined and reshuffling and reshaping the city, I think here we've got a bigger problem of more people. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to step back now, and Bryn is going to give you a quick explanation of how he thinks we can take a look at problem solving or the different ways we can go through the future history, which we've given you for the 2010 to 2016, the context in which you're going to be living in to make your decisions. And with the benefit of hindsight, because you've already been to the future, the second half of the session, which Marta will run, we're going to deal with feedback through hindsight now of how to get the right things done between 2006 and that future period. And then Julian's going to sum up to give you a hint about what relocalization is all about and why we have to do certain things without question. So, Bryn?
Thanks, Rick. Who here is just learning about peak oil? Is anybody kind of just getting into it? Okay. And how many sort of diehard peak freaks have we got in the room? Obsesses over this stuff entirely too much? Just kind of curious. My name is Bryn Davidson. I come into this from a background in engineering. I worked actually in Alaska for a while, putting air conditioning into North Slope oil modules so that in the middle of winter you could air condition them. Which didn't make a whole lot of sense, but moved to Vancouver to study sustainable architecture, and through that I've started studying sustainable planning and then come into the peak oil field. I'm currently involved in setting up a green development company to do eco-industrial developments, and through that had the interesting opportunity to speak to a number of CEOs and talk to them about their future and the future of their business in moving into what is an energy challenge future. And what comes out of this dialogue is an understanding that the people that are really into peak oil and understand it in a certain way are a pretty small segment of the population. But the solutions, the things that need to happen are very broad. And so the main challenge I see at this point is figuring out how do we create a dialogue that's inclusive, that actually has meaning to the people, to the CEOs, to the leaders, the governmental people. And so that's what we're hoping to get at today, is to find an approach to talking about peak oil that engages people, and you can really start to have a common language with which you understand how all these forces interact. I suppose some of you have seen recently headlines like this one, oil pipeline shut down in Alaska to choke flow. Lots of world events happening these days which are highlighting our dependence on oil. But at the same time, there's a debate about whether this is due to peaking or just, you know, geopolitics or any of these other kind of things. So I think what this leads us to is the fact that with peaking, you don't really know you've peaked until you're over here kind of on the downslope. And so I believe we're probably somewhere in here in this kind of plateau phase where there's a bit of a debate. There's a lot of people who say we are, we aren't. Over here at some point in the future, the jury is going to be in. We're going to say, okay, our conventional resources are depleting now. What are we going to do about it? So the approach we're going to try and take today is in two parts. The first is to look out here at the future, 2016, 2020, whatever you want to say, and talk about what that future looks like. And then after we break for lunch, we're going to come back here and talk about this plateau period from now to, say, 2012, and talk about the events, world events, how we got there, what are the decisions that we made, how do we, amongst these various futures that are possible, how do we collectively begin to create a preferred future? So that's that's what I see as hopefully the exercise. Going to So we have here, as again, these are different predictions for the sort of peaking of global oil and gas conventional resources. And you can see there's a lot of different opinions about this. There's the people who believe that we're peaking now and are facing a pretty imminent decline. And there are some people who say, oh no, we've got lots of things, tar sands, shales, other kind of stuff, which are going to keep us going on into the future. So the question then is, from my point of view, is, okay, even if we do have those resources going off into the future, we're dealing with issues like climate change and environmental impacts, followed by almost a really precipitous decline, which is kind of scary in its own right. So amongst these, we have to figure out, how do we begin to create a preferred future given some idea of what might happen? So this is where the idea of the scenarios came about, saying, okay, let's not outright say what's going to happen, but let's look at a few different things and try and understand the assumptions that are built into each of those different kind of worldviews. So we have on one end, there's people who believe that the peaking is going to happen kind of late or be a pretty slow decline. There's a lot of people that are in that segment. There's some people that think peaking is going to happen early and it's going to drop off fast. Now amongst those, we have a few different ways that we can respond. And I've come to call those sort of proactive and reactive in terms of whether we try to create a preferred future or if we just rely, say, on, say, the market to create things for us. And so what this does is it defines four scenarios. If peaking happens late and we just bring on a lot of extra fossil fuels and we just allow the markets to go, I call this scenario burnout. Also, it could be climate chaos or business as usual. So this is one kind of worldview, and there are certainly a lot of people out there that are pushing for the kind of business as usual. If peaking happens later, but we're actually very proactive about reducing our fossil fuel dependence and reducing our CO2 emissions, I call this scenario techno markets. This is also sustainable development. This is this idea that we're going to transition gradually using our conventional market systems over a long period of time. Now, if we go into sudden decline of oil and we haven't prepared at all, we'll call that collapse. And this is the one a lot of people are kind of scared about. And I think it's really important that we talk about this because we need to understand the vulnerabilities and the risks that are within our societies and our systems and talk about the way that things can actually fall apart. Then finally, this one, this is a lot of the peak oil crowd is focused on this one. I call it lean economy. A lot of people call it power down. This is where depletion comes on, but we manage to transform our economic systems. We relocalize, we bring in local economies, local money, all these kind of things. So this is one kind of future that a lot of people are focused on. So what I'm hoping to do is that we'll go through and take a piece of the city or kind of theme and go through each of these. Talk about what the city looks like in each of those states. How do we get our food? What do we live in? What do we do for work? All of these kind of things, just as kind of brainstorming about what the city looks like under these different conditions. Now, in terms of the part about creating a common language, I think it's really important that we all begin to sort of be able to talk about the sort of major forces that are acting here. We have sort of conventional oil and gas. At some point it's going to peak and then decline at a certain rate. Now if it just kept on going, that would be sort of business as usual. And so we have a couple of different options. We can bring on new supplies, renewables, shales, tar sands. So we can bring on supply, and we can bring down demand, how much energy we need. So these are the two kind of sides that we're working with, supply and demand. And amongst those, we can bring on sort of dirty supply. These are the things that are, you know, your shales, your oil sands, things that are increasing greenhouse gases and all this other kind of stuff. And then there's the renewables. On the demand side, there's two parts as well. There's demand reduction, which I see as voluntary. This is, you know, moving from the suburbs into the city so you don't have to drive every day. That's reducing your demand for energy in a voluntary basis. The other part is demand destruction. And this comes about by high prices or by shortages. If the price of gasoline doubles or triples, all of a sudden maybe you're not going on that road trip for your holiday. You're going to hang out in town instead. So the price has destroyed your demand for oil or gas. So it's important that we begin to understand that there are these kind of four things at work. And the critical thing is how quickly they can happen. So say tar sands, for example. Right now, production is about this much. And the idea is that in 5 or 10 years, it's going to be this much. You don't just flip a switch and all of a sudden have a zillion barrels of oil coming out of the tar sands. You start with a little, and it ramps up at a certain speed. And so the question is, when we look at peaking, if it happens slowly, and you bring on tar sands at this speed, you may actually be able to increase your supply. If your conventional resources go like this, and you bring on tar sands, it's still not going to actually have an impact. And so this is the major issue that we're dealing with, is that all of these things happen at a certain speed. Changing the city happens at a certain speed. And so there's a lot of uncertainty about how quickly we can bring on, say, something like solar, or how quickly we can change out everybody's cars. An example from Australia, they changed the rules, shifting from leaded gasoline to unleaded gasoline. It took 15 years to change out the entire fleet of cars. So it just has to do with how quickly new technologies, you know, if we discover fusion tomorrow, it's still going to take a long time to change out the entire fleet of cars and trucks and everything else. So this is the major issue, is how quickly these things happen.
Bryn, sorry, how does policy and legislation fit into those four components that you've got there?
Yeah, let me get to that. It's perfect, because I mean that's what we're trying to get at here, is exactly those questions. And I wish I could have this a little bit bigger. So here's the four scenarios. Slow depletion on this side, rapid depletion on this side, and then these different wedges. In some scenarios, there's demand reductions that are smaller. In some scenarios, the demand reductions are huge. And this is where we start getting into our policy and the decisions that we make. It's do we make the choice to bring on clean fuels that are maybe more expensive, or dirty fuels that are cheaper? Do we choose to reduce how much energy we use, or do we focus solely on trying to bring in new supplies? These are the major kind of decisions that we have to make that create different visions of the future. Has anybody seen this PowerPoint online? Is there anybody familiar with it? These are kind of example scenarios from each of those, and I hate to read things in presentations, but I'll do it just to kind of give people an idea. So this quadrant, this is techno markets, sustainable development. Slow depletion, new technologies come on quickly. So conventional oil peaks before 2010, but the depletion rate is buffered by non-conventional sources and rising prices. Governments reform tax laws around energy and the environment. Carbon sequestration, putting carbon back in the ground, allows us to use fossil fuels cleanly. The green sector, green business, green economy grows rapidly while the others decays. And developing third world countries leapfrog to new technologies. This is what a lot of people are hoping for, and it's based on a certain set of assumptions about how things can change. There's a lot of people talking about carbon sequestration, which is to say you burn coal and then you put the carbon in the ground and you use that energy to, say, create hydrogen or something else. You're basically decoupling emissions from the use of fossil fuels. And that's a big hope that a lot of people have, but there's a real question about how quickly that can scale up. So we go down here and talk about the burnout scenario. This is the one where we're doing everything we can to keep our cars running. Non-conventional fossil fuels offset depletion, so tar sands and shale kind of cover up the depletion of typical reserves. The price of oil hovers around $70 for several decades and drives us to coal, nuclear, and unsustainably harvested biomass. So we just start cutting down trees or using our food sources for fuels. CO2 emissions skyrocket. Habitats, farmland, forests are decimated in a search for energy. Superstorms, rising sea levels, desertification, all these kind of climate chaos issues. So this is the impact of if we just keep on this sort of fossil fuels track, this is sort of one possible future. This side, okay, oil's peaked faster. So oil peaks around 2010 and depletes faster than anybody really expected. But the governments have rapid conservation plans that they formed back in 2006. And so they're able to bring those on quickly. Political and religious groups come together to support international cooperation. And they help to avert armed conflict and the widespread use of dirty fuels. So this is about really coming together to create this sort of positive future in the face of a challenge. The global economy transitions with the help of price and supply shocks from a global-centric to a local-centric model. So this is about transforming the way we use money, transforming the way we create food, all of these things, in relation to the fact that our conventional oil and gas has depleted quickly. Of course, the last one, collapse. Oil and gas deplete quickly, but we don't react so well. Conventional oil peaks before 2010 and depletes rapidly, faster than substitutes from tar sands, coal, and oil shale can be scaled up. Faster than the tar sands can scale up. Declining global fuel supplies lead to negative growth. Investors lose faith in the stock markets, just like in 1928. And currencies collapse. High prices and shortages cause demand destruction. But the base level of demand is too inelastic to contract voluntarily, i.e. we're too dependent on oil and gas to just take it out of our lives voluntarily. Natural gas in North America peaks and declines faster than we can bring in liquefied natural gas from the Middle East. Nations battle for resources abroad and fight unrest at home. Unemployment soars, global travel and the globalized economy collapses. Health and food crises are rampant and populations contract from lower birth rates and lower life expectancies. A pretty dire scenario, but it's also a plausible future. So the question now is, as we move forward, we need to talk about what our cities look like in each of these four scenarios. How we live, what we do. And then after lunch, we'll come back and talk about world events, things that happened, how we got there, the decisions we had to make. The idea here is to try and figure out what are the elements for all of us that embody a preferred future. And what are the decisions that we need to make over the next several years in order to put ourselves on that path? And how do we use energy crises, whether it's something like Alaskan oil pipeline or a crisis in Saudi Arabia or whatever, how do we use those events as catalysts to really rethink the way we deal with energy in our society? So hopefully, I guess at this point, I'll just take questions. If anybody have any questions about these scenarios, what are the assumptions underlying them? Because you're going to go back and try and imagine what the world is like in each of these four conditions.
Question with respect to the techno markets. You're assuming that market modeling is still the basis for everything, as in market status quo.
Yeah, the conventional, the globalized economy is still more or less functioning. It's just becoming a green market.
And is... Okay.
And is the economy still supposed to or expected to grow in order for us to continue, or is there anywhere in the scenario where an economy can be consistent and not grow?
Well, in this, that's one of the things you're going to have to talk about. I'll look at this version here. The black line is the total amount of energy we have. In the techno markets case, we have conventional fossil fuels plus a whole lot of new clean technologies that are actually allowing our supply of energy to grow. In this one, we're bringing on clean technologies, but it's not enough to offset the depletion. And so in this case, the economy will have to really transform, because it's hard for your traditional economy to not grow. Our traditional economy is founded on its need to grow. So this one, that's why I call it lean economy, because it's really about transforming the way we use money, the way we allocate resources, all of those things. This one is about creating sort of a green market. This is, you know, your typical green building kind of strategy, sustainable development, smart growth. all of these ideas taken to a big scale.
So can that line be expected to continue at that sort of slightly upward angle indefinitely, or because you're still depending on renewables, right?
Yeah, in this scenario. So this is the question. There's a lot of people who believe that this is what's going to happen. And so if that's what's going to happen, we have to say, these are the assumptions underlying that belief.
Right.
And if you don't, there's the one that you think is the most probable, which is different from necessarily the one that you think is preferred or the one that's possible. That's in terms of talking about a language of futures. So we want to understand the assumptions that are behind this. And you're highlighting them perfectly. Big challenges.
So you brought up things like the techno solution and green buildings. And I, for one, would be one that would say I don't think a building boom or building permits is going to dig us out of problems like this as they occur. Also, policy and legislation have been brought up.
Mm-hmm.
But really, when you get to a local economy, it does come down to things like governance and how people relate to each other. And where within these models are we looking at, because by and large, we haven't gotten out of extremely authoritarian types of paradigms in the way we relate to each other.
No.
So I'm wondering how we can address that, the very real social dynamics of being in a community, relating to the nature around you, whether you're in the city or not, and being able to share the resources and preserve them at the same time.
Absolutely. And all of these things are located within one of these scenarios. And so, governance is going to be an important issue in each one of these. And so maybe in part two, we can talk about from now, 2006 to say 2010 or 2012, what are the discussions that we need to have? Who are the people that need to get on board? What are the pilot programs and how quickly does that have to happen in order to make, the future that you see come about? But first, let's talk about, what does governance look like in a lean economy scenario? What does governance or the lack thereof look like in a collapse scenario? What were the weak points of governance so that it fell apart? Over here, let's look at governance maybe being overwhelmed by market demands. And here it's, governance getting behind a wide-scale sort of transformation of the economy and market.
It seems to me that on your left, right, up and down axis, there's a Z axis between liberal, democratic, and totalitarian governments as well, which is not, your assumptions all take into the assumption that we're going to have a market-oriented collapse or success. And there's no what if we had a Stalinist government that just turned around and said, you're green, or you're going to Siberia.
Maybe if you look at voluntary
axis in your diagram.
Then put it in there. The idea of getting this much voluntary demand reduction, I don't even know how that would happen. Maybe your Stalinist government has to come out of this. I don't.
The army rolls out into the streets and says, we're enforcing, local stuff. Is that an orange from California? Well, that's a realistic scenario. It seems absurd right now that we wouldn't have a market-oriented solution, but in fact, 10 years ago,
well, this is exactly why I wanted to go with the scenario approach, so that we can bring out those things and not be afraid to talk about things that seem out there now but are in fact fairly plausible. So let's just figure out, what does that represent? The army coming out to control things. Maybe that's an example of a collapse scenario. And so we'll put it in there, write it up.
Can I throw in one thing that I kind of heard, though? When we're looking at the gaming here, there's two ways of looking at it. And we're looking at it and saying, what is it in Canada that we would be dealing with? So it's plausible solutions based upon our cultural norms. That's one. You want to bring in that context, sure, but that's more like a China model right now. They are mandating. So the question I want to understand is, if we're going to game this, are we doing it within our context?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay?
That's,
because that's really key, because some of the things that you're dictating would not happen in our cultural norms.
But that's what I was asking, though, is are we resting on the assumption of liberal democracy and market as a context.
We're talking about
democracy.
The GVRD.
So we're talking about
yes.
I mean, within 5 or 10 years, is it plausible to think that we could have a fascist green government in Canada? Well, it seems absurd. It seems absurd, right? But 10 years ago, it seemed absurd that we'd be fighting over oil in the Middle least.
Yeah.
So
I'd ask you to capture that within your sort of either your location or your group, and talk about, you know, this could happen and this is why.
Well, this is getting into the discussion, but peak oil and climate change essentially changes all of our cultural and political values and institutions. And so, and we've already seen numerous examples of this here in the GVRD already. So we have to think about the crisis that this is going to create in democracy and in our political culture as a third axis.
Yeah, that's what
because I'm... this is going to be driven by peak oil and climate
absolutely.
Change.
Absolutely. I see that it's in here, every one of these. It just manifests differently. This isn't about saying this is what's going to happen, or this is what's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
This is just understanding how these things interact with each other and interact with our city.
Mm-hmm.
What's actually going to happen is this, or this, or this. You know, this is an exercise for understanding how demand, supply, technology, culture, all of these things interact and the choices we have to make. So that cultural thing is present in every one of these scenarios, and I would encourage you to write about it or talk about it in your groups. Any other questions about the sort of underlying assumptions or the bits that work together? And if not, then I'll one more.
So I'm thinking ahead of, you know, once we do the groups, are we coming back and talking about what we've talked about? Are we
sure.
going to present various types
we'll
of
come back and we'll try and capture some common themes within each of the scenarios. Try and talk about what are the elements that maybe make up a preferred future as opposed to the ones that we've illustrated.
What are you going to do with our discussions and findings?
That's a good question. Anybody have an idea?
I'll say a couple things. The reason we're asking for record takers in this group is we're going to use that to compile a report like we did last year. And from that, we have a grand idea. This takes so much energy to do these things that we want to actually formulate this to become a package that will be on the web, or a manual that can be sold, or the team can go out and help other people do this in other communities. So this, we want to use this as a virus to spread, as somebody said today. The other thing I was going to say, are you finished, Bryn?
I'll answer whatever questions are left, but otherwise, have at it.
No, but there was another point there. I didn't want to repeat what we did last year totally, but anybody that read last year's report, there were 6 pages of Socratic questions in that one, which was given as the context for the discussion that happened in the groups then. And they were things like, when these things happen in your community, and you lose your job, and you can't heat your house, and you can't afford to commute, what is happening to you and to your family and your community? How are you responding? How are you learning to work together? One of the things we're trying to do with this thing is to avoid the Mad Max syndrome. We're trying to find the soft landing for people to work together. It can't be stressed too strongly that when I started researching this a few years back from a different perspective, and I looked around the world to find out who was dealing with this in a social, cultural way instead of just leaving it for everybody else. There's only 2 groups in North America that were really worried or researching what to do when things, and it was when things went wrong. It was the army and the police. So this addresses your question about, does a fascist condition arise? If we don't take care of things and take control and correct things, it is possible for even a society like ours to go someplace else. And that's why we're doing this, is to try and be aware of it and avoid that horrible scenario.
And I think there are some actually other aspects. You know, for example, if you want to look at green agriculture in the city, we have a massive industry in BC. In fact, it's the largest economic base we have in the province, bigger than forestry and fishery, and that's the grow-op industry. It's also very market-driven. It's based on shortage, it's based on very high prices, and it's a complete criminal infrastructure that spreads corruption throughout the province. On the other hand, we have food bank approaches that share produce from gardens with people that are hungry, and these are 2 economic market and need-driven scenarios that we might compare and contrast, because those will be the challenges we face, what we're going to engage in. And they're largely ethical. They go beyond governance. They involve day-to-day decision-making, how we relate and how we exchange and transact.
So maybe if I can just use that as an example, we'll take your piece of the city and say, okay, here's, in this case, it's 2016, and the grow-ops have transformed into this whole sort of food
what
production market.
What happens to them when the electricity runs out?
So then, part two, come back and talk about how between 2006 and 2016, the grow ops were able to transform. What were the events, the politics, the discussion that happened that allowed that transformation to happen? So part one, description, what's going on? Part two, how did we get there? So I guess all these ideas, try and capture them, rather we'll have them on tape here, but try and capture them within your groups.
What the nature of that on tape, will that be available in a comprehensively?
I'd have to ask the tapers. I'm actually not sure what the logistics are.
It will be available via either global public media or local public media, one or other or both.
I don't understand what that means. What do you mean by
globalpublicmedia.com has been around about 5 years.
Okay.
And we have been offering in-depth interviews, audio and video, available on demand, around complex issues, particularly around energy issues, but not confined to that by any means.
Okay.
So,
So we'll go into the groups and we'll have 15 minutes for each scenario. There are we have about 6 to 10 groups. Six of them are place-based. There's a little piece of the city. And so you have, say, there's one of them that's sort of downtown Vancouver, and there's four of those, one for each scenario. So each group will go through all four scenarios with a certain place or a certain theme for 15 minutes each. And so after me, Julian's going to give a bit of a talk, and then we'll break up into those groups. Any questions about the sort of general logistics of how that operates?
Yeah, sorry, I'm so late. I meant really, actually, and I didn't have a chance to read through all the materials. So how is the group thing working? Can you just briefly explain that? Because there's going to be six groups altogether for the workshop, and this is a different...
We're going to break into smaller groups.
Yeah.
And
that's just it.
Before we break in, before Jillian talks, I want you to think about the kind of group you want to go into. There are six pieces of the city, and we like 4 to 6 people in each of those groups. But there's also other groups that are theme-based, like business, intergovernmental relations, big business trying to maintain itself as things are failing. Then there's a couple other, or if you've got an ad hoc situation where you've got people of like interest you want to sort out. So, before or after Julian talks, first of all, let me ask, how many people would rather deal with a general open theme or focus like in business or government or something, and how many would rather, let me do it the other way, how many people would rather deal with a piece of the city?
Sorry, which question was that?
Let me deal with it the other way. How many people don't want to deal with a piece of the city?
Well, actually, I've got a question because most of your scenarios are based on archetypes, and they're very personal. Point Grey, Sally, and Kitsilano, Kate, and stuff.
You don't
like
have to
that.
Follow those. Those are just for those people that can't get out of their own mindset.
I'm just wondering why you chose that, and you haven't really discussed that.
The reason for bringing those forward and illustrating them in that way is to point out that there's so many varied people in the world. When you're talking about your community, don't just think of yourself. Think about your aged parents or your kids that want to go to college but can't because the system's collapsing, or you have kids to take care of, and I mean just think of everybody in your community. So if you find it easier to take on one of those roles and play that role, just please do. It's up to you.
I think of the 65-year-old woman living on the street in my neighborhood, which mm-hmm. happens to be Point Grey.
Okay. You're going to be her tonight today.
Yeah.
We have the costumes in back.
This is an exciting opportunity. I understand what you're trying to accomplish. My concern is we just got to get 15 minutes on each scenario, which seems like a minuscule amount of time.
It is.
And then you also have this provocative...
Which means we should start shortly.
And you also have this provocateur system, which you've talked about. I'm not sure if you're going to be using it. I'd just like to get a better understanding.
Okay, this process is unfolding. We've been kind of putting it together in our spare time, and it's kind of came together at the last minute. At the end of this, we'll hopefully say, this worked, this didn't, this is a good way to do it in the future. So, to a certain extent, we're going to be making it up as we go.
Are you going to use this provocateur?
I'll probably roam around and kind of ask people pointed questions and have a little. Anything else, or should we go on to Julian?
Just the one point was the groups are, people haven't been allocated to these groups yet. It's all self-selecting.
Yeah, there's urban, rural.
No, I'm just wondering, there's
sure.
Group one is urban, which is basically physically Marpool and Richmond, Fraser River area. Group two is a suburban view, which is Abbotsford East and farmland interface issues. Group three is ex-urban, so that's Gibson's sort of mountain away from the city. Group four is what's called economics or industry team, which is False Creek Flats, physically across the bay over to North Dam. Group five is environment team, which is in Delta area, so basically the Superport farmlands, foreshore area of Delta. And group six is socio-cultural team, which is UBC Point Grey, the river, the harbor, and nature. The four other groups that Rick mentioned then was there's a business survival, which is not physically located, it's just as a group or a theme. Intergovernmental, really big business, and then foreign affairs.
So I would actually ask you to go to groups of four or five in each one of those and fill them up as seems per your interests.
And they're in this room itself, they're physically located, one back here sort of working their way forward. So five and six are out there, one and two are back here, three and four will be in here. And we can move around if we're space constrained. There is an outside deck area, but it's a bit windy. So.
Just a question on logistics. If we, I'm actually thinking that the government group might end up being bigger than four or five. Is there has there been thought given to dividing that up into themes? Like I'm actually thinking that that it might be worthwhile to have a group that is dealing with something very specific, like the International Energy Agency's saving oil in a hurry scenario.
Okay, well, I guess I would ask you to maybe even take a piece of the city and bring that into these scenarios. Saving oil in a hurry is a strategy for rapid demand reduction, which would probably come in here.
Yeah, it's a transportation only.
Yeah, so take a piece of Richmond or something and say, we're saving oil in a hurry by this, and bring that into the place-based scenarios, because we want the places are where all these things intersect, government, money, economy, politics, social, all this stuff comes together within those places. So, hey Julian, we'll jump in there before keep rolling.
Thank you very much for coming, and I wanted to first make sure that I thank all the work that Rick has put who's here today, and Sarah Smith, who is one of the relocalization network coordinators who can't be here today. As I'm sure you all know, I expect many of you have put on events in similar size and smaller and larger. It's a lot of work, and we're going to need a lot more events in getting together and discussing things. And I'm particularly pleased that we're having a kind of workshop. It will be a workshop, because when people actually get into smaller groups and start discussing serious things, modeling them, in this case, discussing scenarios, and later on actually getting down to things, okay, we've got a certain resource or a certain lack of resource, what are we going to do? And this is very good practice for doing that. Now, I'm just going to speak for about 15 minutes or so and talk a bit about global relocalization and what that means, and just give you, I hope, a few sort of practical elements and a bit of context. There are those, and there was recently quite a famous American politician who's made a useful film about a global climate chaos. Yes, it was good that he's brought it to the attention particularly of Americans, some of whom have been challenged by the idea that climate change is happening, despite the evidence that we see. There are a couple of things that I would take issue with over that, and I think unless we grapple with those things, as we
enter into the carbon chasm, which I think is what we're going into, in other words, a shortage of hydrocarbons, not mentioned at all in the film by Al Gore at all, even though we know he knows about it. He said very clearly at a couple of points in the film that he felt this was a moral issue. A moral issue, and he also posed the opposition, perhaps the dichotomy, between economy and environment. And he said there are some people who say we have to choose between the economy and the environment, but he feels it's a moral issue. And I comprehensively disagree with him. One, it is not a moral issue. It's going to be, I'm not saying there won't be moral issues, and there certainly will be ethical issues. Ethics is much, much more about decision procedures. Morals comes from the Latin meaning habits and customs. And yes, we're going to have to change our habits and customs, but as you most of you know, when we speak about a moral issue, it usually has a much higher dimension. There's a dimension of there's a philosophical dimension to this, and I think philosophy is tremendously important. I spent some of my life discussing it. But the trouble is, when you say it's a moral issue, it sounds like other things are moved off the agenda. Like, it's not an economic issue, it's a moral issue. It's not any of these other issues, which I think are much more concrete. The thing is, when you talk about economics, or when you talk about resources, when you talk about oil, or when you talk about peanuts, or corn, or the amount of sun coming from the sky, those aren't really moral issues. Those are material issues. Those are often issues about molecules. And when you actually start talking about molecules as opposed to morals, life actually starts to get really tough, because then you have to make real decisions, which ironically may well be moral decisions. So what I'm trying to say is if we keep our minds focused on the moral issues, I fear that we will ironically fail to deal with the very molecular, the molecule issues which cause the moral issues, and we should be turning our attention first to dealing with the molecule issues, and then we will really have to consider the moral issues, but do it that way around. Because after all, we don't eat morals, and in fact, we don't eat money either. We eat food. And when we start getting faced with challenges with food production, there will be tremendous moral issues, but we will also need to be looking very carefully at soil and looking at the interplay between soil, sun, rain, plant types, and very interestingly, an interrelation between all those things and mussels, which generally don't come in very much to industrial food production right now because it's all substituted for by oil and gas. So that's a very important dichotomy I have between that and that otherwise very useful climate change film, Inconvenient Truth. And the other matter is, and I suppose you could say that a politician who may yet still have another crack at President of America, or indeed any practically any other political platform, has got a deep problem with this challenge between the economy and the environment. And I come out flatly and simply and say, there is a huge challenge between economy and environment, or ecology, and we shall have to choose. And I believe it will mean either we have some kind of environment that life forms can exist in for the coming X thousands or millions of years, or else we'll choose the economy path. And of course, if I am correct that there is this dichotomy, you wouldn't have one or the other, the economy, of course, won't last very much longer anyway, and certainly not the oil and gas-powered one. So I think that's going to be a real challenge. It's not something that many politicians who expect to get elected could stand up and say, because we've built this whole system of economics, which has furnished everything in this room, has got us here mostly. I came here by bicycle, but I didn't make that bicycle. It was made in the economy, hopefully most of it in North America, but no doubt the chains weren't and so forth. So we have become highly dependent on the economic system, and now particularly the global economy. And one of the reasons why we have done that is the need for specialization. Once you start settling, once you start doing agriculture and stop being gatherer-hunters, you are more or less forced into some kind of social situation, and you are almost bound to get a developing economic system. And of course, one of the features that comes out of the economic system is the need for money. So we start to see that this comprehensive, colossal industrial economic system that we've built, especially in the last 250 years, looks like an absolutely necessary entity, and we can't really imagine life without it. And one has to say that there are some big questions about running a planet with 6.5 billion people, even if 5.5 billion of them are in pretty dire straits. Nonetheless, that's about how many humans we've got, and 1 billion in the rich world are reasonably well off, some indeed very rich. So we're used to this economic system. I think it's going to be very severely challenged by the coming energy decline, the carbon chasm, as we get into trouble for oil and gas, and later on get into trouble for coal, but perhaps more because of the carbon dioxide emissions from coal. That's one of my great fears, is that we will continue this return to coal, which is already well underway. So I do think there's a challenge between the economy and the environment, and I think it would be, it's my job anyway, to stand up and say that whilst others either believe it's not the case or shy away from it. I have to be, just because of the way I am, fact-based rather than faith-based. I think just believing in things, wishing that they were true, is all very well. As Jim Kunstler points out, it's all very well when you're 5, but when you're 15 or 25 or 65, this is not a very good way to plan or run a system. Global relocalization is Post-Carbon Institute's comprehensive way of putting forward a different system. It is not completely worked out. By the very nature of things, a relocalized system can't be completely worked out by one person. It might be quite well worked out by 1 million people or 100 million people, but a system of relocalization whereby we attempt to provision ourselves with our most necessary needs within the locale. In other words, our daily needs should be to a great extent supplied from within the locale. Once you start doing that, it becomes very obvious that the last thing in the world you can possibly do is mandate that centrally. In other words, neither the existing highly centralized, in my opinion, capitalist system, highly corporate system, it's highly centralized. We just have this verbiage which tells that it's not. Just look at the electricity system to start with. Nor indeed the usual kind of communist system that we've seen. These are all highly centralized systems. We need, it's quite clear, decentralized systems, more distributed systems, whereby we produce what we need locally. And that's the idea of relocalization. The re part of it is because I believe there will be a return. There needs to be a return to many of the things that we used to do in the past, which are held, sometimes hidden in the history books, ideas of renewal, recovery. The re-word is very useful, and there are dozens of words starting with re, which I think we'll find very useful and will give us pointers in the right direction. That isn't to say that the word localization, which I also use and which other groups use too, isn't important. That it is re-localization. In other words, localization is the essence of this, and the re points us towards some of the method. The global part. Global relocalization is a comprehensive antidote to globalization. Why the global part? And I think as soon as you start thinking about relocalization, you'll think, well, wait a minute, if I do it very well locally, and let's say I was blessed with everything I need, all the metals and all the corn and the food, and we managed to maintain healthcare and everything you can imagine. If we do that for, let's say, 100,000 people, and around us there are 10 towns, cities, settlements of 1 million people each, and they look in upon us doing well, and meanwhile they're in a species of chaos like Kazakhstan or something of this sort, or other places we can think of, do you imagine, especially if they have a few guns sitting about with some ammo, do you imagine they're going to sit around and watch the Emerald City flourish, meanwhile they are in a state of pauperdom and impoverishment? I do not think so. The history books are full of no examples whatsoever. Of course, those with the weapons and the force will come along to the people with the stuff and take it away. So it seems to me that the only answer is to do this globally, by which I mean regionally, at the county level, at the state, at the province, at the national level. In other words, as many places as possible need to link with each other and, as it were, build each other up, sharing ideas, sharing resources, and yes, there will still be some trading. We've been trading for many tens of thousands of years. Whether it's a good idea or not is another matter altogether. We've been doing it, but we'll be doing a lot less of it. There'll be questions about how we do it, the transaction method, the kinds of money we use. Will it be national or federal money, or will it be more localized money? I'm very interested in this subject, and I've written about energy-backed currencies, for instance, local renewable energy. So the global part is actually very important. And as I say, by that, I just mean integrated and doing it on a wide scale. The tagline of Post Carbon Institute is reduce consumption, produce locally. That is the method by which I think we shall achieve some kind of longevity, some kind of possible sustainability, although I fear that the word sustainability should be reserved for the 22nd century, if we're lucky, and we should be using the word contraction for the 21st century, because that's what's in store for us. And by contraction, I mean planned reduction of the system, basically, and to including our consumption, of course. I believe unless we do contraction, and I reinforce the word planning, unless we plan for this, we will have these unpleasant scenarios of chaos, collapse, and all the other kinds of things, burnout, that we really would like to avoid. Because apart from anything else, there's no guarantee that we won't be caught in the burnout or the collapse. So it'd be very good for us if we plan for something else. That, if you like, is the method, the reduction of consumption, the production locally. The goal, however, is provision and protection, I believe. We need to provide ourselves with both the endogenous energies and feedstocks, food, and some exogenous, you know, the heat, the light, and so forth, though trying to do it using much less and producing it locally. It is precisely that provisioning, which is so much of it, comes down to this molecular level, the food, the energy, the feedstocks, the fuels, and so on, that we shall need. And also the caring. And if you think of the provisioning here and protection here, if you sort of join them together, you can look at caring and healthcare, because you need to provision people with care when they need it, but also you need to protect people from diseases. You need to protect people from the bad foods and the bad settlements, which have to such a vast extent made us this ailing, sickly species, which we've become since the agrarian revolution during the last 10,000 years. If you think about it, what other animal has hospitals and a million drugs and a $1 trillion drug industry to somehow sort of keep itself limping along into its maturity and senility? Other animals, I know animals got find grasses and, you know, the right things to eat to keep them going and if they feel unwell. But by and large, they don't put themselves into sort of coronary rehab and this kind of thing because they don't have those opportunities. And yet they look, until we came along anyway, pretty strong and healthy. And this operation has been going for about 3.5 billion years. So nature, with getting something right, and by the way, one of the two of the things that nature doesn't do, one, nature doesn't do agriculture, especially industrial agriculture. I mean, there are aphids and things like this, but you know what I mean. And nature doesn't do economy. Look out there. No other animal does an economy. They just either run around and catch things, or they take nutrients from the soil, or they eat the plants, and so forth. It's just a provisioning and protection operation in that sense. And so that's one of the things that I will encourage you to think in terms of that way. I've used the word protection in that sense, not because I want to encourage mafia-like rackets, but because the word security has rather been colonized by some people who are on the right. And there's the word independence, especially energy independence, which has been taken up by some who are on the sort of center to left. And I think either of those dichotomies, whilst it can be interesting, also has some unfortunate baggage attached to it. We are dependent creatures, after all. All life forms are dependent on other life forms and ultimately on the sunshine and many other things too. So that's basically what I wanted to encapsulate, this idea of relocalization needing to be done in an integrated way, that our goal is self-provisioning, closing the loops, getting as much of our food as we can locally, and protection from the elements, since we've managed to site ourselves in so many stupid places in the last 1 to 20 million years, but particularly in the last few tens of thousands of years, we've got ourselves into some places where we really shouldn't be, including Vancouver. I mean, without fire and basically taking fur in the past and flints to cut things and many, many other tools and actually quite basic technologies, we couldn't manage in any of these places. So as we have to reduce some levels of technology and the availability of energy to fuel those technology, what implications does that have? Now, how does this, in the last sort of minute or so, this plays right into planning. And one of the things that Post Carbon Institute has been doing very strongly, especially in the last year or so, is increasing our contacts with municipalities. Indeed, we have commissioned and are having written a municipal resource guidebook to help municipalities face energy vulnerability, as peak oil seems to be a word that municipalities find more difficult to deal with. So energy vulnerability seems to be a reasonable phrase that municipalities can cope with. And also we're working on a citizens toolkit, if you like, to help citizens talk to municipalities. And both of these should be available in print and electronic form before the end of the year. And the reason for that, and the reason why we're so interested in municipalities and in planning and so forth, is unless we do something about the infrastructure, most of the other things that we would like to talk about, such as closing the loops, local provisioning, won't work. If you want to do district heating, you need the municipality, you need planners. If you want more sensible housing, ditto, you need the same thing. If you want to have mixed use live-work spaces, if you want to change the zoning, if you want to do more urban farms, and so forth, the list is absolutely endless. If you want to do practically anything other than the very worthy cutting down of the individual consumption, if you want, by the time you get on to serious demand reduction and moving back towards local production, if you think of trying to make eyeglasses or trying to make local steel, vital things that we all need. How would you make knives locally, for instance, or wind turbines or solar panels or shirts or trousers or shoes or practically anything you can imagine, including food? The zoning is against you. It's just absolutely amazing. This zoning thing, this single-use zoning, is a total disaster, and it's also produced the strip malls, which I think are just a catastrophic mistake, and we'll really have to sort of start tearing those out and tearing them down and going back to something that looks much more like a sort of European arrangement where you wrap things around squares, or in Italy, for instance, and Spain, you wrap things around squares, and in London and places like that, the squares are sort of facing out a little bit. But many of these European models were developed long before petroleum, long before big energy, and they have survived a lot longer than I think the high energy arrangements that we've now got. So this is why planning, municipalities are absolutely vital in the coming arrangements, the change of arrangements, and unless planners and developers and municipalities are involved, I think the future does look rather forlorn. The great thing is, as planners and municipalities do become involved, things do look a lot better, because no matter how gruesome things look at in terms of national politics, when one thinks of Harper and Blair from my own country, and Harper from my second country as a Canadian citizen, and John Howard in Australia going for a fifth term, it all looks very gruesome at the national level. At the municipal level, however, we have one of our post-carbon board members is a former and I believe future mayor of Huntington Beach in California. You, amongst you, are either, there may be some electeds here, or you're about to be, you can be. The point is, at the municipal level, you can become involved. There are things you can do. And so this is very exciting, and this is one of the reasons why I think the scenario building, the modelling that we're about to do today is actually tremendously important, and I think there's a great chance here, and I think there will be great interest in replicating this and developing it more. So I hope with those words, which are position how important this is, and if some of the more dramatic things come to pass, how vital this work will be. I hope that for any that need it, and perhaps none of you do, but for any that need it, it will sort of add some steel, as it were, not necessarily locally produced yet, but and some strength and some spine to what you're doing, and to face some of the more difficult scenarios and say, yes, this unfortunately could really happen. And I do commend the booklet that Rick and the team has produced, because there's some pretty vigorous assumptions and suggestions in that booklet about what might happen. And I think grappling with those will be of tremendous assistance to all of us as we go forward and try to change the kind of plans and the planning system that we've got. So good luck, and I shall be very interested to listen and where I can answer any sort of more supply-side questions as we go through. And I will just mention my book on natural gas, High Noon for Natural Gas, is still, as far as I know, the only critical book on natural gas. Natural gas will become a huge problem. North America peaked in 2001 in natural gas. It's a very important matter for planners, because so much energy in the planning world comes more from natural gas than perhaps oil, although not regarding transportation, which is extremely significant. So this is still around. The last chapter talks in considerable detail about relocalization. And I will bring from the office, which is within walking distance, some post-carbon brochures, our new brochures, and some postcards on the relocalization network. So those will be available after lunch, and I do encourage you to pick those up. So with that, thank you very much. And on to the game.
Ask each of the spokesmen for each of the groups to speak for like 5 or 10 minutes, whatever they're comfortable with. Some people said, oh gee, we're not sure again the conclusions, it doesn't matter, that's not the important part. And then after everybody's presented their part, I'll ask Bryn to sum up what he thinks and where to lead us next, because we want to go into a general discussion, and I'm going to let Marta chair that, because she's good at that. And so who's number one spokesman? Come up front, Shirley. Can't hide that.
Hi. We our group was John Cross, Alyssa Myshock, Marta Forvag, and Shirley McGrew. We did the lean market scenario, we did collapse, and we did techno. And I think one of the things that was really interesting is that in none of the scenarios did we abandon tech. I expected that when we got to collapse that we would be in a Mad Max scenario, and we didn't. What we decided was that tech was so important that we would legislate oil. We would put oil and all other kinds of energy on rationing so that information systems could be retained. Otherwise, we thought our society would completely collapse into complete and utter chaos, and that there was no necessity for that. So that was one of the most interesting things. One of the other things was that we thought a whole lot of possibilities for housing hasn't been met. There's a lot of retrofitting in any of the scenarios. In the collapse phase, it was more like getting way more basic, like a lot less energy is used in actually heating, and energy was used for cooking. But in techno, a lot of new stuff was going to be coming on stream, and we were going to be upgrading the houses rather than collapsing into much smaller houses, which was the collapse phase. Interesting, the lean market scenario was very interesting in that we actually started using the river. We were in the Marpole area, and then we had Sea Island and Richmond, and then the rest of Richmond. And one of the really interesting parts was that we actually started to use the river. The industrial areas were starting to become two-fronted so that they could be accessed from the roads, and also the river started to become not only a ferry system to get across the blockage of the water, but to actually use the river as a commerce source. There was a lot of discussion whether the suburbs had an advantage over food supply from the city. This is the dense city. This is the sometimes dense and sometimes not dense suburbs. And this is the entry to the airport, I'm pretty sure. So the idea was that these big open areas would become market economy, agriculture in the lean market, and we didn't discuss it with the other ones. But this is the river, and we realized that the river is used for commerce now, but it's actually not used by the general public. And we thought that would become a lot more interesting. For instance, having floating markets and things like that that would go up and down the river with the produce that was generated on these big market farms here. So that was one of the interesting ideas, was actually bringing the river way more into people's ordinary lives. And of course, the usual things of, you know, a lot more bicycles. Another interesting that came in the lean scenario is using these for fast buses, some of the major arterial routes for fast buses, so that neighborhoods started to get rid of their cars voluntarily rather than having to actually legislate it. And governance, we realized, became a really big issue in every single one of the scenarios. Were you actually going to tell people that they could not do anything? Or were people actually going to voluntarily come to that conclusion themselves and agree to it? In the collapse scenario, we actually introduced rationing because there was just going to be no discussion about it, or else there's no hospitals, there's no police, there's no fire, and there's no transit. So that the governance in that scenario was very autocratic, but in the other scenarios, it was, and especially in the techno scenario, it was rebates and incentives to try to get people to come along with things and to try to introduce new energy systems. Also, one of the interesting things in the urban area over here is we had a discussion about lanes in especially the collapse scenario, and realized that a lot of the lanes could actually become minor pathway streets, whereas the garages, since we have no cars, became
suites.
Became suites, and then the lanes became little laneways, and the alternate use for it was to become shops, because the international market had disappeared, and we had to have some sort of a rural economy, and the laneways were perfect for that. Since we had all these empty buildings that used to house cars, they became shops, and you could go up and down the laneways to do your shopping. And then we realized that it would probably become hierarchical for the shopping, that you would have to go to bigger and bigger centers to get some of your needs fulfilled, because you'd need X number of people in each one to service you. And let's see, what else did we come up with? That's pretty okay, group. Did I skip anything important that you think I should have said?
No, very good.
And Rick gets the notes.
And Rick gets the notes. I can actually write it up, sort of like a story.
If you promise, I get it.
I will.
Before we go to number two, can I just ask everybody that's here today to email me their feedback on how they felt about this and what they can do to improve it? Don't just say the group's dealt with it. I want to hear from everybody, if you'd take the time. And send it to rick@newcity.ca, which you have somewhere already.
Okay. Thanks.
So career group two, we dealt with, I guess, a suburban environment in Abbotsford. And I suspect, like most, we had a lot of difficulty dealing with all of the many questions and scenarios. So we only really managed to talk about the lead economy scenario and the collapse scenario. And even then, obviously, didn't manage to cover quite as much ground as we wanted to. But I guess the main issue we talked about, given that it was Abbotsford and there's agricultural land around, was food. And so we felt that in either situation, I guess there'd probably have to be some major changes because of the way agriculture typically happens in this area is large-scale commercial agriculture, and that it would have to be reoriented to support the local needs of Abbotsford and perhaps the surrounding areas, and that the reality is that Abbotsford, I guess, has some very good soils and good potential for agriculture production, so that could be potentially, at least in the lean scenario, a possibility for some excess capacity for export elsewhere. But that there would obviously have to be a big push to preserve and potentially claw back agricultural land in this area and to move towards more diverse crops. I guess we spoke a lot about transportation and the fact that there's a lot of unknowns in terms of where people will need to go. Obviously, we can do a lot to change development patterns to support people using alternative transportation and local everyday trips. But since there's so many question marks about where people's jobs might be, and you know, people living in Abbotsford now may commute long distances to jobs in Surrey or Langley, but as to whether those jobs would be around in a restructured economy and whether it'll, you know, it's certainly unlikely that it'll be quite as inexpensive to travel there. So what type of transportation infrastructure we'd want to create is difficult to anticipate, but that we'd probably want to encourage policies that encourage or mandate even carpooling and maybe, in my opinion, at least investments should be not in very expensive fixed transportation infrastructure that, since we don't quite know what we'll be having to deal with. And it's sort of maybe a bit rambling, but in any event, there's just certainly a lot of uncertainty about these issues, but I guess food, transportation were the main ones in the lean scenario, and in the collapse scenario, we were quite concerned that even though there is a lot of agricultural land there, there's likelihood that agriculture may become unprofitable because there's so many high energy inputs into agriculture as currently practiced, and there's potential of these partial abandonment of some agricultural productions happening there, and either way, even though there's a lot of agricultural potential capacity in the area, there's likelihood of inadequate production even for meeting local needs in a collapse scenario, which is obviously frightening if we think about what might happen in a more urban environment where there isn't even the land available there. We had some debate about whether the likelihood of sort of more local urban agriculture and backyard type agriculture being likely to be successful, and had some debate discussion about that. But obviously, at least in the collapse scenario, where food scarcity becomes possible, or maybe likely, who knows, that obviously raises a whole host of security issues as well. Not least of which because you have a prison right nearby, so I don't know. Anyone else from the group wants to chime in or add any other points?
We talked a lot about densification.
Yeah, we did. Yeah, densification and trying to, I guess, again, change to the extent possible in a 10-year horizon, change development patterns to allow people to do a lot more of what we need to do on a daily basis locally, and changing zoning to allow people to have shops and live close to where they might work or need to be, and subdivide lots and that sort of thing.
So Dan, why is the old downtown of Abbotsford where it is?
Well, I don't know the history of Abbotsford, but I suspect, like many places, it's because of transportation infrastructure. That's rail yards. Rail that goes right through. Is it two rail lines that converge here?
Technically three, yeah.
Three? You're the expert.
Yes.
So in European villages, often the farmers actually live in the village. Is this what you think will be happening in Abbotsford? In other words, rural people won't be living isolated lives, so they'll have access to more urban and more community-type settings, and the farmlands will be managed in a different way. Or, you know, are there any changes in land management in terms of community management?
Yeah, we didn't really get into that too much. I guess it's a huge big debate about, like, question about how you would manage agriculture. I'm certainly not very knowledgeable on the topic, but you could imagine any number of scenarios, I guess, of either large-scale agricultural production, probably not as energy-intensive, but still, who knows, maybe run by large agricultural corporations, or it could be local farming practices. But it's, I don't know, in my opinion, this isn't a small European village, whatever, even whatever idealized version we have of that anyway. Like, people, I don't know how people are going to get, if there's in a limited energy scenario, I don't know how you get from your farm into town very easily for your needs, right?
You raised an interesting topic when you said the prison is nearby. Can we afford to have prisons that cost us $60,000-$80,000 a prisoner? They don't do any work under a collapsed scenario.
Can we afford not to have prisons when we have a collapsed scenario? I'm just being devil's advocate. But
why do we have prisons? And what is the nature of the outcome of some kind of a system model? Perhaps.
Well, there'd be so much more work to do. People would find more purpose in their lives. And I think that the crime level would drop.
Or there'd be mass scavenging and fighting over the scraps, and we'll...
That's the ultimate scenario.
And then, prisons pop up everywhere.
Nobody's stealing the food in your garden.
Yeah.
I think we should have a seminar just on this topic. Mm. So you're through then?
Yeah, that's it. Thanks.
Roads actually going to the location, and it's all ferry traffic that supply, in terms of the supply chains. This whole community at present is predicated on diesel run ferries and large semi trucks bringing food to Safeway, and also all of the energy supply. So when we looked at the four different scenarios, we weren't really sure in terms of the level of breakdown, so we just kind of made it up, a couple different scenarios. So basically, this area is a very benign environment, so if the energy shock happens, it would be a very desirable place to live, because the weather is very temperate, and you'd be able to survive the winters without huge amounts of stress. There may be a population influx, which might need to be controlled somehow, because there is quite a lot of land that would be very suitable, and you could sustain yourself in this geographical region. So basically, if I break it down, the lean scenario was, I guess, the sort of utopian vision of a completely cut off sustainable local economy, where some kind of refinement or processing of materials that are all produced locally along the region would be produced here, and there'd be a local supply chain and economy that's based regionally, because there's a series of islands and smaller communities that go up the coast. So because it's geographically separated from the mainland, I think this would be a really good location to actually run a sustainable social experiment, just because of its isolation. So in the lean economy, we were thinking a wartime scenario, like World War II in London, where a lot of lawns and whatnot would be converted into urban agriculture. Transportation would be like electric bikes. There's not going to be a lot of oil available So we were thinking, if we were gonna spend 10 years going into 2016, we might set up solar-powered greenhouses to produce local agriculture and maybe low-impact urban buildings. So everyone's sort of, you know, you don't get your traditional suburban house, but you're allotted, you know, 900 square feet in a building complex that's built in such a way that, you know, recycling the water and all of that kind of stuff. We're thinking, you know, in terms of political organization, we could divide these sections into wards, and I think it'd be a lot like Cuba in terms of the use of land and people producing their own food, but local trade would be the local economy would allow people to buy more specialized goods from, you know, maybe up the coast where there's, you know, dimensional lumber being produced. So that's kind of like in the best case scenario if you were going to plan out the use of this land so that you have like this sustainable model. The techno model is similar, but there'd be it would still trend towards a sustainable local economy, but the goods that are produced here would be shipped to the mainland, and there still would be some moderate trade with the mainland, but that would be not significantly reduced, but it still would be reduced because of the oil driven transportation to get things on and off.
Is there a non-oil driven transport system with the rest of the world? And if not, then does this place basically sort of slip back to a medieval level of technology?
Yeah, I mean that's probably more the case in the collapse model, where, you know, what we were, you know, the first two is the proactive approach where urban planning, like states of urban planning, come in to effectively use what land resources are there and organizing the people in a way that it's kind of a communist system or a commune system where localized wards are being represented by individuals that kind of report on, you know, energy usage, production of food, just to maintain the sort of collective colony. But that's in more of a proactive approach where you're sensibly allocating resources and land to sustainable enterprises. The collapse model. Food is a big issue just because most of the food production is just brought in on semis. So there'd be an issue of quality of life would kind of reduce and services would reduce in the collapse model. So yeah, maybe that would become a bit more, you know, medieval, and there'd be small pockets of people kind of living off the land and maybe, you know, up in the hills, you know, creating like
what
girls? I don't know. Somewhere. Big fitness. So there would be self-sufficiency, but it wouldn't be very organized, and it would be probably driven by sort of survivor island kind of politics. And then the.
Are you getting a TV show out of it?
Oh, yeah.
And then the other scenario that we're thinking about in the, well, there's that, or the other scenario for burnout and collapse is because it's such a desirable place, then you'd have basically environmental refugees coming from the U.S. Kind of buying up this area and creating essentially a gated community where you'd have people, you know, you'd have basically like some kind of military patrolling the influx of people, and it's kind of like an access only if you're able to buy your way into
Is that a problem? Is it isolating? How would they get there? There's no gas. Mm-hmm. That being invaded is the last thing they have to worry
about. If there's...
So, and well, we were just kind of thinking, because what would be the trends, because it is an isolated piece of geography. So it's either like this, you know, communistic utopia Cuban urban farming scenario, or it's kind of a gated community where only really wealthy people can buy access into it. But either way, it's in the scenario, in either scenario, it'd be a desirable place to live just because of access of water, low population, and it's easier to control the scenario. Like you wouldn't have, like, it wouldn't be like, if everything just collapsed, it wouldn't be like a New Orleans situation. So
if there would work for wealth, if there isn't wealth, I guess, you know, this so-called wealthy people.
Yeah, I know, it's a good point. I mean, if the currency systems collapse, then what?
Who are you?
So I don't know.
And actually, Gibson's was incredibly self-sufficient in the past with fishing and forestry.
Yeah.
And it was actually a global community of people from all over the world that came here there and built homesteads. They were peaches against their walls, and mm-hmm. it was very diverse agriculture all up and down the coast.
Yeah, so I think, I mean, in terms of the trend and cultural history of the place, I mean, it's already sort of a left-leaning kind of community, so, you know, hopefully it would sort of go into that sort of commune system where everyone kind of, like, became organized that way. So that's about it.
I just want to point out in terms of scale that from Gibson's is about 1,000 miles to Juneau. It's just like this. So, on another note, my wife was up there yesterday dropping my daughter off an UBC course on footprints and sustainability, and she ran to the people that ran or opened the first co-housing project up around Roberts Creek. And she said, "Isn't that wonderful? I read about that." And he says, "Yeah, we feel burned out. It's been 22 years of in the NIMBYs." She says, "But on Roberts Creek, up in the beautiful Sunshine Coast, no, they don't want us up here either." Just for those that think you can get away with idealism.
For downtown, we basically, spent a lot of time discussing meta-meta conversations, but we did actually get to the scenarios. In the reactive scenarios, we basically saw the collapse scenario being a giant, frantic effort to scavenge downtown. First off, the downtown area is filled with lots of resources. The best place in the world to live, and this high concentration of resources from the oil economy. So there's lots of things that people are going to start stripping off of everything. For instance, if you have all these high-rises down here, and you've got all this glass, and you've got wood, and you've got everything that is going to get, you know, economically, the food out in the... We have to find a way to get the people in the suburbs to trade with this high-density area in the center of the city for their food. And in the collapse scenario, we've got lots of transportation. And what we need to do is give the people outside the city something to trade with us for. So we've got lots of commodities like metal and glass and high-tech products. In a complete collapse of civilization, we've got a giant stripping of all of this stuff. We're digging up pavement. We're taking the copper pipes out of buildings. We're just cannibalizing it in the hopes of making some kind of sustainable civilization down the way.
Are
now,
people still living in those buildings?
600,000 people down here. So where we get rid of all of our gas power, we have human labor. We can, for instance, take BC Place, and you say, "Wow, that's some pretty useless ground." Well, if we take 20,000 people and say, "You are digging up the pavement and making a garden there," we can do that very quickly. We can take high-rise buildings, compact the living area down to the first few floors, and then we take the top floors and we put solar panels and gardens, hydroelectric power. It rains here.
we collect water in cisterns on the tops of buildings, and as that water goes down 20 floors, down to our living areas, we generate micro hydroelectric power. That infrastructure is there. It's going to get used somehow. The question in the scenarios is how we get to that. In our sort of techno, in our lean economy scenario, we have communes that we form in little block areas where basically you have these tiny little neighborhoods, like a sort of a green Yale town where everything, work, living, and transportation are all in a tiny little area, and we have these tight communal areas where we have lots of reuse of our washrooms and our refrigerators. We have solar panels on everything. We've got gardens everywhere. In that scenario, in the proactive scenarios, we still have an energy economy, so we still have an information economy. So down here we've got manufacturing and we've got all sorts of technological economies that are running off of green energy sources. In the reactive scenarios, in the bottom halves of the scenarios, we just decided that the business as usual scenario, this will just keep turning into residential. And basically what's going on now will keep going until it all just falls apart. But we saw all of this getting turned into residential and so forth. I mean, that was the worst scenario for downtown, is that we just keep the energy economy going, and then there's just kind of all this useless infrastructure and a kill-off. We talked about the use of the water spaces here. Most of this is used for big industry or for recreation, but we could replant it. We could have aquaculture. We could have lots of transportation around this area. I mean, if there isn't big boats going through here, we could farm seaweed on the surface. So in the different scenarios, depending upon the level of civilization collapse, there's a lot of things we can do to reutilize these resources with all of the manpower we have. We can transport things back and forth and around through muscle-powered vehicles. If we have at least a little bit of electricity, not on an individual level, I'm not talking solar panels heating your house, but if we have enough hydroelectricity, we have rail to move things in and out, and we can have efficient transportation downtown where we're getting our personal transportation on foot, but we have sort of efficient green hydroelectric technology to move commodities around. We talked about this area here and what would happen to the industrial area between Terminal and Commercial Drive. And what were the four things we came up with? In the techno future, Vancouver will look like it looks now, but better. We'll still have a technological economy where we've got green businesses, green high-tech businesses, all concentrated along power, and in these little communities, you know, you can have green high-tech business going on down here where people are building high-tech green products and living next door or above where they live, where they shop, where their friends are.
Under collapse, it became a slum.
Yeah, this is a slum. In collapse, this area down here just gets squatted upon and people try to...
People can arrive in the city by train from refugees.
And it's unowned.
So we reckon it could become
slum. Right. One of the big problems, sorry.
We also suggested that federal legislation would eliminate all capital gains on housing and essentially decimate the housing market, make it so you couldn't profit on owning a house or owning residential land. And the only value you could build is in investing in an efficient building that would actually house you, could actually be a place where you could be productive, instead of just being a lot for sale. And all of a sudden, the entire Canadian economy could invest in energy efficiency and invest in creating communities that are productive and not just centers of consumption and market economics.
One of the questions we had about reclaiming land down here was around reclaiming parking lots, urban infrastructure that we can't really get rid of. It's too big and too monolithic for us to to dig up, and turning, what are we going to do with like multi-story parking lots where we can put gardening on the top level and maybe some dirty industry or something in the middle levels and stuff like that. But how to reuse the urban landscape of downtown. We talked about what's going to go on with the harborfront. In different scenarios, the harborfront would sort of keep competing with residential, particularly in the burnout phase. What else did we talk about? We talked about all of the, I think we basically got rid of tourism as a useful thing. But things like, you know, what do you do with BC Place? I mean, it's probably several million tons of concrete, but it would make a great collective garden. It's got all these different tiers on it and stuff like that. We could take the top off of it and replant the inside of it. But we have all this infrastructure of modern society, and you're going to have to do something with it. I mean, the Cambry Street Bridge is useful, but, you know, isn't there a lot of parking space down here that's going to be turned into agricultural land? Well, a lot of it's polluted. Is a question we had was how useful is that land if we start digging up all the pavement? What do you do with all the pavement? I mean, what are we going to do with all of it? I don't know, that was just a rhetorical question.
Can you talk about transportation, the difference between the sort of lean scenario and the tactile one in terms of different levels of transportation? We felt that in the tactile scenario, there would still be quite a lot of freedom of personal transportation. There
right.
might be a hydrogen economy, hydrogen vehicles, and sort of business as usual, almost fixing wood power in a different way. But then in the lean scenario, we saw the resources that we have left being sort of husbanded and used in a way to generate efficient electric public transportation, and then expecting people themselves to use bicycles or horses or some other means of transportation at a personal level, and focus on still providing collective transportation with the resources that we have left.
Personal transportation probably isn't that much of a problem in downtown, particularly if you take the cars off of the road in almost any given scenario. There's lots of walkways and pathways, and if you're fed well enough, you can walk from one side of downtown to the other.
And also we talked about personal transportation. It would become much more easy to use the water, possibly, than to actually walk, so increasing the use of kayaks, so boats of all different sizes, rowing, that type of thing, in order to move around the city via the water rather than necessarily moving through it the way we move through it now.
Do we have anything else for you?
Just before number five gets up here, something dawned on me about the production of greenhouses in this climate. Does anybody know what the factor is between what a greenhouse in the Fraser Valley raises versus out in the open crops? You know, don't you? Because you're at the...
Is that sort of a quiz question? Because if it is, you wouldn't want to give me a prize. I don't know.
You don't know what the number is?
They tend to be five times the inflation. The best ones are
what is
that? Okay, so I just wondered if that was a pop quiz. Not 30 times. 25 to 30 times.
25 to 30? Mm-hmm. I thought it was 20, but that's good.
But you have to look at the energy inputs.
I know, but with this other energies, solar. Like you can even do geothermal and solar and all that other stuff. In other words, we could become more self-sufficient.
Wait. For what crops is that? That's not my understanding.
Well, what they're growing now is lettuce, tomatoes, cucumbers.
For tomatoes, there's a difference. It's a factor of five.
Could you rephrase that?
It's not 20.
Energy required to...
Using a greenhouse creates 25% more.
No, 25 times.
25 times more goods than the same plot of land.
Right.
It was just outdoors.
But I'm getting Harry Blazer here, shake his head saying for tomatoes that's not the case, so we better get confirmation. And Kim?
Yeah, I just wanted to add, I hear, like, in these planning scenarios, often I hear a lot about urban agriculture and the potential for urban agriculture. I don't see actually a lot of potential for urban agriculture in Vancouver. Like, I don't actually see that in the future. Vancouver is still dense enough with enough urban agriculture land around it that you could still feasibly transport stuff fresh stuff in season and then manufactured stuff outside, or you know, preserved stuff outside of season into Vancouver. I still, it's not like, people have this sort of intuitive feeling that gardens will do it and gardens in urban spaces will do it, and I don't see that as actually being that realistic for the most part. When you have a collective humanly developed landscape like that, you're probably going to end up doing more things that are collectively human rather than agriculture. More services, like I agree with the energy scenarios, producing more energy, green technologies. I don't think you're going to find that the downtown area of Vancouver will become an agricultural landscape for East
Richard. There is one living example today of a transition that's been made by a urban society to basically a collapsed society, and that's Cuba. And 50% of the food is grown in Havana for the urban environment, and the rest of it is grown just in the outskirts. There's also quite a few examples in China where that's happening too.
Mm-hmm. I think the other thing is that, like, how do we feed the megacities of the world? You know, Cairo, Tokyo, New York. I mean, there's so many people. When things collapse, how do you do that? There, you're going to have those alternatives.
Also, if you look seriously at the energy requirements for using skyscrapers for doing food, becomes pretty scary and formidable very fast. Like just getting the water to where you need it.
Yeah. Yes. Good.
So, speaking of agricultural land,
can you start with this one?
By the way, are we going to
All right, we were group five. We had a small group, just the two of us. And we had Delta. And to start with, we just identified the key elements that define this community. And they are that there's a ferry, a transportation port here for a ferry. There's a transportation port for goods. We have a suburban community, existing suburban community here, and we also there's also a First Nations community with some existing land claims issues over the land here, and finally, obviously a huge food producing area. So looking at those key elements, we've got through three scenarios, and we can just run through them. So in a collapse scenario, this was a fun one which we got into a bit. We identified that the key driver here is going to be food production, and the first step that might happen is that it would be identified as a key resource for the region, and that in a current in our current system would lead to identification of a scarce resource. The price for the food crops would go up, the value, and this would initiate an ownership struggle between the existing landowners and the First Nations community if there's no other means to mediate that conflict. So the tensions would exacerbate there as fighting over the land would arise, and then what happened next was that the conflict escalated to a point of some violence and blockading of the farmland, which then led to the decline in production and even more scarcity in the region. So this whole area potentially turned into a pretty messy scenario with struggle to use the land resource. And the port, whether there's actually goods being shipped at that point, we're not sure, but there might be a blockade of the access to these regional transportation hubs. Although it turned out that once a month, an armed escort took some rich people or people with resources onto a monthly sailing of the ferry with police escorts through the violent sort of chaos in the region.
And the logging.
And also some of the
existing natural habitat was logged for fuel, as there is no existing infrastructure to support some of the existing people.
How is it logged?
By hand, yeah.
And they just drag the logs? Because large-scale forestry is...
Well, there's not too much, actually, to... It wouldn't take very long for the community here to log this, so...
But how big is the community?
Well, I mean, we're talking... I mean, don't ask us, they logged it. Well, what we're looking at is... decline in electricity and fuel for cooking and heating, and there's people squatting out and trying to take areas of this land, having some fuel to cook turned out to be important, and that's so some of the existing trees there would be fuel. I mean,
was there any consideration of breaking the dikes and turning it into floodplains and allowing the fertility to be delivered naturally by the river?
Any long-term thoughts like that completely out the window, because people are kind of, is it very localized and short-term?
So we're investing a lot of money keeping the dikes in place?
No.
Because they're not going to last on their own.
Okay, well maybe the dikes collapse as well. So.
Yeah?
Right.
Any other questions on this scenario? No?
You guys sure like the collapse scenario.
I know this is one... So looking at the lean market scenario, we envisioned a brighter future, and Daphne was happy to work on this one after doing our collapse. So. And what we saw happening was that the land resource here and the potential to create food was identified, and that a partnership formed between the existing landowners, the suburban dwellers, and the First Nations community. And through this cooperative effort, they created an integrated food production system which kept some of the food localized and used for the existing communities, and an education center was formed here to help bring in and develop some new local knowledge for how to shift our agricultural system, so this area became a test bed for new farming techniques. And there was also a shift from this suburban sort of community to a new central small town center that was in the middle of the farming region here, connected by light rail to the existing downtown and more dense cores. And in terms of energy systems, local energy being supplied through some wind turbines and biomass and some retrofits to the housing was also a part of what was happening there. And so I guess an underlying theme here is this became an integrated farming community with emphasis on cooperation and some local-based economy. And I guess that covers that. There's a question we came back to, but we could go first to the... Yes?
You know, you very much think this area is sustaining itself, but mm-hmm. if you look at it from a wider regional level, mm-hmm. I can see that this region would become key in terms of other people in other parts
right.
of the region would want access to the food, from, you know, either by
right.
draining or by taking. Did you consider the strategic importance of
right.
this area?
Okay, so that was a key question we came back to, actually. That's
yeah.
right. And our question here was, we don't know the numbers on this. How much food is created here with respect to the population it supports? And
is that a question?
Well, we'll just go through and you can maybe provide some input after. But with the two scenarios we were thinking about were, I guess, looking at how much food can be produced locally and to support a local community, and how much would be excessed and could be shared with other urban centers. And
a key conflict that we saw was that whole concept of preserving some for a local community and then deciding to share some extra indicates a breaking from our current economic system where everything just goes onto a free market. Because if that was the case that we preserve in our economic system, then if there are some people who've acquired wealth, let's say from the scavenging of some downtown resources, and then they trade that the food simply on an exchange basis without any localization mechanism, then that will drive further drive a wedge between the have and the have-nots in terms of who owns the land and who is doing the trading for the food. So there would then be the people who are creating the food and then trading that for goods, and there would be people who don't have the capital to do that trading. So that cooperative approach, we see some conflict with our economic system in creating that sort of happy, like localized ideal. So that's a big question: is how do you create that localization if in an economic sense?
So can I apply some realistic comment to that?
Love to.
the fact is that much of this is from Delta.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. Much of the food grown there is already under a localized production system. We actually need to look at it more regionally. There is a supply market system for dairy, and it's a large dairy producing area. It's not the major dairy producing area. However, much of that area would go into vegetable production that is already currently in vegetable production. But when you consider that, that California is facing pressures much more extreme even than BC in terms of its sustainability for food production, like it simply will not have the water, and it is developing rapidly over its best agriculture land more rapidly than BC is. The price point, as you're talking about with vegetables, will be much higher, and it will be even more lucrative than it is now to produce vegetables. And Delta is a fabulous area. It's also a fabulous area for greenhouses. So I don't agree with you. I think that if you look at it more regionally, it will be a major market garden for Vancouver. Right, and everybody in the area will be enriched by the fact that food would be the primary economy, and they would be a part of it. I can't because the labor intensity you're talking about is very large, so everybody in the region that wants to, there won't be any shortage of jobs. Everybody that wants to could be engaged in this very lucrative food economy.
The fascinating thing about Delta and the river is that it's a pivotal point in terms of the tides, and you can go right up to Langley, you can go over to Richmond, you can go up the river and down the North Arm and around the Point Grey into Vancouver. It's a fascinating, and all with tidal power, a mixture of tide and wind, you can do amazing things.
So you're talking about a break point that I think is very artificial, it won't actually exist.
Well, I guess that premise there is that there's enough food.
The rich guys will be the ones in the food business. The poor guys
right.
will be the ones outside of the food business. I mean,
right.
they're...
The rich guys
and then the question is how critical is the
except for me, what happened?
So can the GVRD produce enough food to meet everybody's needs
no.
and then export?
No, it's about one hectare per person for the province. But considering this is such a rich agriculture area and it can be more intensified through greenhouses, you could maybe look at 0.5, 0.6 of a hectare per person. It's not enough land to feed.
So it's not enough land. So
we're a million hectares short of our current population.
Okay, so that's I guess a driving factor, maybe in exacerbating some of the.
Yeah, in terms of shortage, yeah.
Because how can we talk about exporting if we can't even feed our local population?
Yeah, that would be everybody else trying to get in, not us though. You're right. It could happen if, like, China could perhaps potentially be the most wealthy country in the world and the most food starving, and they may set the price for a lot of commercial commodities. But yeah, you're right. In that case, if it's truly that global, and we're not, and trade is completely even, then there would have to be policies that would allow the local population to be fed under extreme price pressure from China.
Is that 0.6 percentile for required per person
current practices or optimal practices?
It's actually a 1 hectare per person in BC. Under current, we're doing studies on that, so we'll have a much more refined number by the end of next year. Mm-hmm. Right now we're feeding 50%, and if we're going to feed the million more people at 50%, we're going to need a million more hectares.
Yeah, but the whole point of the question though is that current practice, I mean, permaculture, all these other things, there's lots of other ways to... that's the big argument.
Agriculture is intensifying at a very rapid rate, mm-hmm. but of course there will be that check and balance of higher and higher input costs. You have to realize all nitrogen fertilizer is fuel-based. Mm-hmm. But basically, under our current commercial agriculture production system, it takes 9 calories of fuel to produce 1 calorie of food that arrives at your home.
I thought it was 13.
Well, it could be higher, but I mean, that's about...
In a commercial enterprise.
Yeah, but that's with all sorts of transportation all over the place and lots of inputs. But we will be, I mean, I agree with, very much agree with your point where you're going to say you're going to have an agriculture technology center. Yes, I believe so. Like Cuba, I believe that we will be developing more learning points like we have in Agassiz. Like Agassiz would say be your future scenario there, where they have a research station. That same scenario would likely be transported, you know, to Delta or to a rich agriculture area like that, so close to an urban center.
I think the other aspect of Cuba was mentioned, and I think that in the agriculture in the cities, the real crisis in Cuba was actually fresh food. They didn't have refrigeration to store, they didn't have transportation to transport. Uh-huh. And what they did was they supplemented their diets and enriched their diets and improved their health by producing fresh foods, even in little square footage places. And they have about 6 or 7 different economic business models to actually conduct this agriculture. They have compost collectives.
Yeah, I'm not writing it off. I just think that often for Vancouver, it's overstated.
The only comment I want to make is whatever does happen in Vancouver will actually be a very sophisticated sense of enterprise. We'll have to be knowledgeable about our neighborhoods, about the trees, about the land that we're using.
We need to keep moving on. We can get into a lot of details.
Yeah.
It's going to be an interesting challenge.
It's a discussion that we've got to keep going for the next 10 years.
Okay. So, to fly through our third scenario, this was the technological rescue scenario, and the difference from this scenario is that there's not a real energy crisis, so we can maintain integration with the global economy. There's not a need to localize as much, and what we envisioned happening here was that this turned into an energy economy hub. So we had large-scale wind development, large-scale fish farming development, a PV generation facility, a clean coal plant, shipping carbon off to be sequestered in the ocean because this is working now, and a hydrogen filling station for the fantastic shining hydrogen economy and the cars zipping back and forth. This scenario is premised on some technological advances, I guess. So, and the nice thing is that it doesn't require a change of lifestyle or changing our economic models. The technological question is a rather large question mark, though. So I guess we saw either the collapse as likely or figuring out something like this is even more reasonable than this scenario, but we did it anyways. So.
Thank you, guys. We've got 20 minutes because we're 2 more, and I'm afraid we're not going to have the roundtable session because we're supposed to be out at 4, but we'll see if we can just pretend that we don't know what time it is. So who's next?
I think we are from UBC. Five, correct?
In Gensler's book, he said, you know, one of the things most at risk are the cultural institutions, so that's why we put UBC out there because it's such a big cultural institution.
So we spent quite a bit of time just talking about kind of the role of the university in these different scenarios.
and what would be the demand or expectation of potential students or the need for education at all in some of these scenarios, and others there might be a definite need. I'll start off with we started in the more positive zone because it's easy to get into the collapse area. We looked at the lean economy, and we thought that there'd be, because of the rapid depletion, there'd be a rapid demand for a different kind of education. So shifting away from maybe some of the current programs into things like whether it be urban agriculture, green technology, for example, shifting from architecture or building civil engineering from being build and design or design and build into retrofitting, and almost all the programs were shifting in that direction. You know, things like solar hot water and stuff, technologies that exist today, how to actually apply them on the ground. So those curriculum changes would happen. We also thought that like the idea of a four-year degree program may be pretty well obsolete, that you would move to shorter duration education, maybe whether it be a year or 4 months, and that the physical location of the university would morph a bit, and that you actually may find that some of these core curriculum or core programs or specialized, as we call them, that were still offered, the ones that weren't offered, they might just go off and let other people deliver them, like let's say an arts degree or something like that. That the university might reform itself around some specific geographical areas that are conducive to farming or conducive to technology and use some of their buildings and things like that that are already there. We looked at the idea of the physical location also meant maybe some of these distributed campuses that the university is already approaching right now. They have like, was it the Interior Campus or UBC of the Okanagan or things like that. So they may actually apply that more around the city, not just on the UBC location, because their supply of students may not be able to get there. So they may have to go to them and use the same sort of approach. We thought transit, there would be some sort of rapid transit line would actually be built up to bigger capacity for the students that were going there, because not many of them would be able to come in their cars anymore as the oil depleted. So that would likely be bus, though. We wouldn't see that on the lean model. We wouldn't see that being a dedicated like rail line or something like that. It would just be happening too quick. They'd have to respond with like a bus system. And that housing would start to, you know, temporary housing for students that are coming for 4 months or a year or something would be allocated in the campus, because right now it's not very good. A lot of this, almost all the housing around the campus is really for wealthy non-students, right? So maybe some of that would be taken back, or some of the existing buildings would be retrofitted to basically increase the capacity. And I think the big thing was that some of these programs would be focused around, you know, the energy, food, shelter, maybe possibly manufacturing sites might appear out on the edge of the campus where there are some things like NRC or whatever the...
Triumph.
Yeah, Triumph and the research centers and all that stuff's out there, the forestry program. There are buildings and capacity maybe to do some of that manufacturing. We had things like there might be port access here. I think there was, on the energy side, they have a distributed... is it a heating system or something like that? So there are some possibilities to use geothermal, some of these other technologies with the existing capacity. On the techno market then side, we saw a lot of the similar things, but this would happen at a slower pace. So you would have sort of the same programs, but they might 10, 15, 20% start moving into some of these green technology or things like that. Then as we flipped into the collapse approach, there was really a couple of. Is there a map here? Yep.
Is there a use for a gigantic urban forest?
Well, we thought on this one here that there's definitely some, there like agriculture and farming could end up being done there, so some of the forest may be stripped down for that, or the golf course might be used for that, but also there was a need for recreation, so some of those might still be maintained. There are like all sorts of fields and things like that around that could still be used for recreation or farming. And there is the UBC farm area, as people are familiar with.
Actually, it's the watershed for Vancouver's last remaining salmon stream and its first salmon restoration.
And there's five or six other vestigial streams that could be restored, including Jericho Park. Mm-hmm. And there's lots of reason to have the forest, and there's also a lot of foraging grounds as well for berries and things.
So on the collapse side then, we kind of dithered about what actually would be the use of this place. Because really there, I mean, who would go there? Because, you know, as a student living out in Langley, my issue right now is not getting a four-year degree certificate in fine arts, because it's getting food on the table or keeping the house warm in the next couple of weeks. So it's either this would just stop functioning as a university, or would become maybe a university for the uber rich, who would, so we could have put a landing strip in here for private jets. And a helipad, if we couldn't do that, we'd have a helipad out to the airport, because that would be protected. We'd also be building port, well, there's already good stuff here for where all the logs are stored, so we'd have to build a port access here for people to come in, or for food, oil supply, whatever. Probably build a buffer zone around whatever size makes sense here, and whatever we could salvage of the university, because of you know, not knowing how their heating system works. Is it just down here that it works really effectively, or do they actually have it out here? I don't know. They may, the size of this would maybe be dictated by the molecular level, as we were discussing earlier.
How are you going to fuel the technology?
Because you're collapsed, right?
Well, but you're collapsed, but you got a lot of money. Because everybody up here is sitting on has got, like, well, they got million-dollar properties, and they maybe got money stored out, and they've got resources that other people may not have somewhere else. So we're figuring that this might actually become sort of an enclave, a bit of a no-man's land around here. We don't know how far out that would go. Like, are the people who are in the Point Grey area, or are they going to want to join up with the downtown people, or are they going to want to sort of say, maybe I'll play my bets out here that this might work out better for me?
So, Steve, before you go on, when you say this is collapsed, would you please explain
which currency you're using?
Sorry?
Okay, which currency is viable when there's a collapse?
Well, we didn't go into that. I mean, and how fast is collapse happening? Like, we don't, again, are we talking about this is collapse overnight, or is this over a four-year period, two-year period? Is that the difference between collapse and burnout? Like, we didn't really look at time perspectives here, and I think that's why we sort of had struggled a bit with some of these different scenarios. But the whole thing here was that the education element of it becomes sort of obsolete, maybe, in the darker reactive areas. So what's the economic model that floats this place? And maybe the economic model's got nothing to do with education. It's actually a nicely located place that, much like Gibson's is in the other example, it's a desirable place to be. It's got some assets that you could leverage for farming and all sorts of things like that. So that's maybe what it becomes, is a place where people flock to. On the burnout side then, really I just saw it, you know, it existing as a diminishing university. You know, the education role still goes on, but fewer and fewer people are going to be able to afford to go there or have a reason to go there. And, you know, the technology areas and things like that, and the curriculum may be directed in, but it may also just be a neoliberal institution that educates the rich to continue the globalization that seems to be working for that on that burnout run. Yep.
I propose one alternative scenario to do with healthcare. Interesting thing about Cuba is they have a very large medical school that provides free medical education not only to Cuba, but to countries around the world that can't afford to educate doctors. I propose that UBC become a center of free medical education for community-based healthcare. That's one scenario that Cuba is really leading the world on and hasn't really been explored that much. Most of us aren't aware of it, but it's phenomenal.
Yeah, I think they blew the budget on that on Martha Piper's going away party. So.
That's right. That's right.
The other example that came up, Eric's comment was along the lines of the idea of education and citizenry in the context of the university. There was the notion of work performed in conjunction with the education. It wasn't but getting to the degree and the CIA. There was a relationship to place and the continuing function of the place whilst there, part and parcel to confirmed degrees, as it were.
Yeah, and I think on the lean or on the positive side of the balance there, that's where some of that stuff may happen. But on the kind of on the reactive side of things, you're going to get into situations where can it change quick enough? Like what it's actually doing, the university, can it respond to that sort of shift, or can it make that kind of shift?
We also touched on that matter of, you know, and what is the mechanism of this in a proactive sense, from the legislative perspective, from a provincial, you know, and the university, the idea of the planning strategies, and you know, how does that morph into the possible, into the new one? Because I think the understanding is that the status quo isn't going to carry. So questions also surfaced with regard to the legislative model and the degree model. We touched a little bit about the European model of education. We touched on that with Latin American experience with free education, but with it comes responsibility and that type of thing.
Not only do they train, but you find Cuban doctors all over the world in the places that need them the most. Mm-hmm. Unlike our system. We don't even have doctors in our hinterlands.
Mm-hmm. I think the other thing too that we touched on with this was, and maybe an observation from all, just from listening to all these for the roundtable, is that there was a bit of local knowledge that really helped when we were going through this. And I've noticed that, like some of the commentary here is, did you know about the tides there? Did you know that certainly, like, you know, the heating system in here, not knowing about that, that's a critical component of it. So that if you're going to actually undertaking this stuff, having people on the ground who, you know, this is an example of university, but having people on the ground who have lived in this area for 30, 40 years, who know how it works, who know which way the water drains in the forest and all that sort of stuff, sounds like it's pretty critical.
I think we all made, Nick, because of the way we did this, and that you've underestimated the location, and that if we go back to a water transport system, this is the most central place between all the places that we've looked at, from Gibson's to Abbotsford. UBC is going to be where all the waterways and all the water pathways converge. And rather than becoming more isolated, I think it's going to become the central location where you can trade your stuff, because you can take it by boat along the coast or down the rivers to there.
It's primarily a cliff. And it's very fragile.
There's lots.
And it's actually inundated with problems. So it's probably going to remain quite isolated because you're above the water. But as far as local knowledge goes, I just wanted to invite everyone to go for a walk after this. And there's an abundance of fresh blackberries a little way over here. And I'm going to take a walk after this and go berry picking. And I'd like to invite anybody who would like to join me.
Speaking about local knowledge, in fact, you can get access on the south side. It's not that bad on the south side.
So sorry, where on the down here?
Just in where, yeah, a little bit further up. You could put a port.
Yeah, I think we'd marked it on the other one here, I think, somewhere down in this area here. So.
Of course, you have to do what they notice in the field.
That's another question in the back.
Well, I just have a question. So that's going to become the enclave for the very rich. Does the UBC endowment lands become Sherwood Forest for?
our big discussion though is whether it actually is here, whether you go out to Alma or somewhere like that. Like, what would be the whole enclave? Because my bet is that most of these people here would want to tie their boat to that thing. But that's
a squirrel farm.
Thanks everybody for coming out. It was really fantastic to see these scenarios, which have been pretty much just floating around up here, all of a sudden out and being discussed by people and bringing a lot of the underlying assumptions to bear. I think it was really fascinating when one of the techno markets scenarios was illustrated and everybody kind of chuckles. That's because a lot of you understand the real constraints and the real barriers to bringing those technologies to bear in any sort of meaningful way. But when you take this discussion out to the larger world out there, there's a lot of people that are pretty focused either on business as usual or focused on this idea that sustainability will come about kind of incrementally through new technologies in the market. And so understanding that those worldviews are founded upon sets of assumptions that either ignore depletion or over-exaggerate the extent to which new technologies can come on board. And understanding how that works and how that ties into those worldviews is really important when we begin to discuss this. So I think all of us, in terms of looking at these four futures, we know that the preferred future we're going to create isn't this or this or this. It's something over here. It has some elements of this. But we do know that between now and 2016, over the next 10 years, we're going to be encountering a lot of world events, other Hurricane Katrinas, Alaska oil pipeline shutdowns, terrorism and instability in the Middle East, all of these things that really will highlight our vulnerability around our dependence on oil and natural gas. And the question is, as each of these comes along and we're forced to make sort of step changes in what we do, whether we make choices to reduce our vulnerability or to try and preserve the status quo. And so I look at, you know, Hurricane Katrina came about, and what they wanted to do in the U.S., I'm from there, was tap the Strategic Petroleum Reserve and then give everybody rebates of $500 so you could continue to afford your gasoline. So they were using that crisis not as a catalyst for improving their society, but as trying to preserve the status quo. So I guess as we're going forward in each of our endeavors, we're each doing in our own little section of the world, we're trying to develop energy transition strategies. We're looking at how can we, our business, our families, our homes, transition away from oil and cheap gas while preserving the sort of best aspects of our society, peace, democracy, health, all these things that sort of define what your preferred future are. And so I guess I hope that this was useful in terms of being able to talk about things that are potentially out there but at the same time plausible. And if anybody has any feedback on this process as a way of talking about these issues, I would certainly like to hear it. And if anybody wants, there's a PowerPoint version of this in a slideshow on our website. We have a group called the Dynamic Cities Project, looking at peak oil and climate change and city planning issues. And you can download PowerPoints of this and other resources. So thank you for coming and being part of it.
Thank you, all of you, for coming, because you've given up a Saturday of your life, but I think everybody's learned from everybody else a whole bunch of stuff, because this kind of conversation doesn't take place very often. And we hope to be able to take this to make something that you can actually go and borrow and take other places and expand this thing, and other communities can build on it. We're going to try and do a manual and hopefully maybe be in post-carbon or whatever. And anyhow, thanks everybody. It's been great that you came out.